because Elijah did awesome, awesome stuff. Like, he challenged because people were starting to be like, you know, oh, we don't like God, we're going to worship this other dude, right? And that's obviously wrong. And when they were doing that, God was like, okay, Elijah, you're going to go prove him wrong. And so Elijah went over there and he challenged them. And he said, whoever can praise their God and say, light this bowl on fire, and the bowl lights on fire, you're right. And Elijah did his thing where he actually soaked the bowl with water and put like a trench around it, some crazy stuff, and giant explosion, and the bowl ignites on fire because God is God. And even after that, Elijah didn't believe in himself. In 1 Kings 19:4, he sat down under a solitary broom tree and prayed that he might die. I have had enough, Lord, he said. Take my life, for I am no better than my ancestors who have already died. After doing something so amazing, he just didn't believe in himself anymore. He said, I'm no better than that other guy. Just let me die. And I can relate to that a lot because everyone was always telling me, you're doing so good, you know, you're in the youth group, you're helping people there, you're loving people, you're being a light at your school, that kind of thing. But I always felt like I wasn't good enough kind of thing. But looking at that verse, even Elijah, who made a bull explode, he still felt that way. So everyone needs hope through God. Everyone does. No matter who you are, you all need hope.
And then on the flip side, I also looked at Paul. Paul was somebody who, he wrote half of the New Testament. But before he did that, he was persecuting Christians, that's us, with deadly force. He was taking them to jail. He was killing them in some cases, I believe. And, I mean, that is probably one of the worst things that you can do. I mean, if you ask me, but it's not about me. And he was redeemed. I can relate to that a lot. In my life, I've done a lot of not so great things. I broke my best friend's heart multiple times. I was sneaking out at night to go to parties and doing a lot of really stupid stuff while I was there. And my life was just running on this train track where the train was being derailed and I was falling into a pit of despair that I couldn't get out of on my own. And I couldn't. But God is good. And I had this wake-up call recently. I was driving down 528 and it was raining really bad. And my car hit a puddle of water, a really big one, and my car hydroplaned. I was going about 70 miles an hour. And my car inverted. It went 180 degrees in less than a second. I hit the car parallel to me, and I spun out really bad. I could feel the car was about to flip, and in my mind, the only thing that I could think was, God, don't let me die. And God is so good. Because while I'm making eye contact with the car behind me, I'm 180 degrees. I'm like this. I'm looking at the people behind me, and I'm not afraid. Because I know that God's not going to let anything happen to me. My car went off the road. I went into the woods, and I got cushioned by a bush in between two trees that if I had hit, probably would have broken something. And not the car, me. But God is so good. Because in that moment, I wasn't afraid. I knew he wasn't going to let anything happen to me. And ever since then, I've been thinking, what am I doing with my life? What am I doing? I have this second chance. Paul had a second chance. And do you know what he did with it? He wrote half of the New Testament, people. When you're given a second chance, you have hope. You have hope to be able to come up here and talk to you guys and be able to say, yeah, I messed up, but I'm okay. And you are too. There's nothing you can do that God's not going to go, I love you. And with that, we move on to Romans 5, 3 through 5.
And not only that, whoa, that was loud, sorry. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulation, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance, character, and character, hope. Now hope does not disappoint, because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who has given it to us. So, I love that verse so much because it shows the whole life cycle of tribulation and perseverance and, you know, life sucking and embracing the suck and getting through it all, right? And from that, you get character and you get hope. You become who you are. That's what character is. It's who you are. And you get hope in Jesus. And that's what it all leads to. It doesn't lead to character. It doesn't lead to the suck. It leads to hope through God. Hope for a better life. Hope for an eternal life with Him in heaven. And that we could maybe give that to others.
And Isaiah 40:31, but those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not be faint. Because I think the reason that this verse really resonates with me is because even before I was going through all of those terrible things and choosing to do them, because it was a choice. It wasn't, nobody forced me to do that. I had some things that weren't going well in my life, but I chose to do that. And even before I was doing that, I knew the miracles of God. And maybe in your life, you know God, and maybe you know the things that He's capable of, but you feel lost. But you know that He can do this. He can make you soar like an eagle. He can do all these amazing things, and maybe we just need a little bit of a kick, and we can get going back in the right direction. We can walk and not be faint. I mean, when I was doing all of these things, I was tired. And I mean, it's funny. But I wasn't tired as in, oh man, I really need to sleep right now. I was tired of life. I was thinking, I would look at myself in the mirror at night, and I would think, who are you? This isn't you. You know, I'd be hunched over a toilet throwing up and thinking, what is your problem? I'm serious. I mean, I knew that God was so good, and yet I was choosing to do all of these things anyway. And, you know, I've seen people healed of cancer. I've seen people who can't walk again because they were prayed over. I've seen babies that shouldn't have made it make it. God is going to make you so much more than you think you could ever be. And you just need to let Him into your life.
I actually want to talk on that first a little bit too, because this last semester, really the last half of the semester, I have been running on totally empty. I've had basically 6 college classes and my high school band and church, and I was trying to take care of my friends and make sure they were all good and, you know, show them the love of God and stuff, and it was too much for me. I could not do it. But with God, I could. And I had the hope of God that there is going to be an end, because a lot of times I felt like, oh my gosh, why would I keep going on? Is this how life is going to be? Is this all it is? Just work, 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 and no fun? Because, I mean, that kind of sucks. But then I'd come to church on Wednesday, and I'd come to church on Sundays, and I'd hang out with my friends who also had the love of God, and it would just be this pick-me-up, this recharge on my battery. Pete used to talk a lot about how you have a bucket, and that bucket can be full or it can be empty. And if you don't fill up your bucket, you're not going to be able to give it to other people when they need it. And every Wednesday, every Sunday, every time I hung out with the good friends I have, that was filling my bucket with hope, because I saw that's not all life is. It's not all darkness. There is light. There is hope in Christ.
Okay. And now we want to talk a little bit about, why do we have hope, right? Because we talk about that we need it. We talk about that we do have it, but why do we have it, right? So one of the reasons that we have hope is because Jesus died on the cross to cover our sins. I mean, isn't that amazing? I mean, let me simplify this, okay? You do something bad. You can't fix it. You've already done it, but Jesus can, and He has. You know, sometimes we're fighting this fight where we're trying to redeem ourselves, but the battle's already been won. We are already saved. We just need to accept Him. You know, we already have that. We already have Jesus to cover our sins. Not that we can just go and do whatever we want. That's not what that means. But it means that when we do mess up, that God is there, and He's already covered that for us. He's like, yo, like a good neighbor, Jesus is there. No.
I love you so much, Christian. And through that, it's not only that it's okay that we mess up here on this world, but it's that that gives us passage to heaven, and it gives us an open relationship with God where you don't have to do it all on your own. You can always talk to God. He's always there. You can pray, you can worship, and Jesus is always there to talk to you and have a relationship with. And I don't know what I would do without that relationship. And it's just, there's always, he's always there. And it's just so good, because if he weren't there, it would suck a lot. And because he is there, we have that hope. He gives us that hope by being there for us.
I want to touch a little bit about that as well. With that amazing relationship that you can have with God, it's not a, God, I'm only going to come to you when I'm crying. I'm only going to come to you when I'm sad. It's, would you only go to your friends if you were always sad? No. God loves you. He's your father. He wants to be proud of you. He wants to see you soar like an eagle. He wants you to do amazing works in his name, and he wants you to talk to him all the time. Something that I've been trying to do more of is not to just talk to him and have a conversation, but in my head, I'm always talking to him. I'm talking to him right now, asking him for the words to say. It's an open relationship, something that you can always talk to him, and he's always there.
And in that worship song we were singing in worship, the main chorus was, he is your friend. God is your friend. So that's the thing about, I just went totally off topic, but worship, when I was young, I would sing the worship songs. I thought I was getting it, you know, sing the worship song and be happy and stuff, but that's not what it is. You have to sing the song and believe it. And I think there's a song, but it says, if you don't mean it, don't sing it, kind of thing. And I feel that so much, because that, when I heard that, I was like, wait, am I doing this wrong? Because when you really sing it and you really mean it, it's so much different, so much different. So, yeah.
Now we're going to continue on to why do we have hope with Isaiah 40:28. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. You can't even begin to understand how amazing God is. I can't. And he saved my life multiple times, you know, not just physically, but and spiritually. I mean, if you looked at me 4 years ago and you looked at me now, you'd be like, whoa. I mean, it's the things that he can do is unbelievable, literally unbelievable. There are people out there that don't believe that he is doing these things, and we can see them. I've seen people be healed by stage four cancer? Stage four cancer. And she's awesome. She's fine. And we don't believe. There are people out there living their lives without a hope because they don't believe Jesus Christ saved them. And that would bring us to, how can we use hope to help others?
So Matthew 28:18-20. Then Jesus came to them and said, all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. Therefore, go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you. And surely I am with you always, to the very end of the age. So at that end of that scripture, it says, I am with you always, to the very end of the age. He's always with us. And with that hope, we gotta give that to other people. That's the whole point, is that we give it to other people and we bring them to God and to heaven. Because the more people we reach, the more God can be praised. And it's just so good, because that verse just, there's so much hope in that verse, and it doesn't say the word hope at all. But all authority in heaven and on earth has been given to me. It was given to Jesus. And what did Jesus do? He gave it to us. To use for him, to bring people to his name. It's just so good.
He's amazing. the amazing thing about being in a good relationship with God, sorry about that voice crack, that was pretty amazing. The amazing thing about being in a good relationship with God is that sometimes you can lead people to God without ever saying, hey, did you know about Jesus? Some of the most influential people in my life didn't talk to me about Jesus for years. Trevor Gregg, I believe, talked to me for years. He was like a dad to me. Pete, even. But Pete was a youth pastor, so that's a little bit different. He still is a youth pastor, just we haven't fired him. Yeah, I'm the new youth pastor. I'm just kidding.
We're in trouble. But,
and these people were so influential in my life because they were people that I needed. You know, I mean, that's something that I struggled with for a while, was not having that kind of authority figure in my life. And to have someone there that loved you and cared about you and led me to Christ without me even realizing it, I mean, obviously you should still, I think, I'm a firm believer of going and telling people what God has done in your life. I've done so today. But some people, they'll push you away if you do that. And I think that it's amazing that your actions are going to speak louder than your words most of the time, if not all the time. And their actions, by showing me that they loved me and by showing me what God has done in their lives, has really changed my life. And I believe that we should do that for everyone, that we should speak with our actions more than our words.
And on that same kind of note, I have a friend that I brought to our youth group, and when they heard the message, they totally flipped it on its head. They totally took it the wrong way. I explained it to them, and they were like, yeah, I see what you're saying, but no. And I was like, well, but you see what I'm saying? What? And they were just like, no. And even though for years I've been there for them, I've been their friend, I've loved them, and they see that and they know that, and they saw how much I was struggling this semester, and they were like, how are you doing this? Like, they wanted me to leave them. They wanted me to not be there for them, to not give them hope, because they felt like they were too much. And I told them, no, you're not too much. I can do it. Of course I can. And they were so confused. And it's because of God that I could do that, like I said before. But like Christian was saying, sometimes when you bring up the word God or Jesus, people freak out and they run away. And you gotta kinda, you know, slip it in a little subtly, you know? You gotta, you know, a little sneak attack. Jesus! Boom.
Did you just say Jesus sneak attack?
Yes.
I think that might be my new catchphrase. But yeah, I mean, sometimes people aren't gonna be receptive to the word of God, and you've gotta, you know, you've gotta kinda beat them with Jesus subtly. Yeah.
Yep.
So I want to talk a little bit more about the kind of miracles that God has done in our lives. For me, obviously, he saved my life from a car accident, which was amazing. And the unfortunate part was it wasn't my car. And so I'm still praying for miracles to happen financially so that I can, you know, pay off that person's car and that they don't attack me. They won't, probably. But it's so amazing that God is here. He supports us financially. I mean, my mom and I have been struggling a lot with money lately. And we keep telling each other, you just need to be faithful. And that's another word that comes in when you're talking about hope, is faith. Because you have hope because we have faith in God. We have hope that he's going to fulfill our needs because we have faith that he's going to fulfill our needs, right? And we have faith that he's going to keep his promise and that we're going to go to heaven and have an eternal life with him. And we've been trying so hard to have faith that he's going to do that for us. And it's been working. I mean, he's been helping us incredibly. And I don't know what I would do without him. Actually, I do know. Because I lived that.
A miracle that God did in my heart was I went to camp, and it was just this last year, I think, and they all blend together when you go to so many. And I was still actively hurting myself, and that's not something you want to hear, but it's true. And I'd actually promised to someone I knew that I would never do it again. And of course that didn't work. Of course I still did it. Because it wasn't with God that I made that promise. I had hope in my friendship with someone else. I had hope in my friend with a human, with a person. That's not the same as God. God is different. God is greater. And I found that when I really didn't want to do it, because I was using it as a coping mechanism, and when I looked at it and I saw that it really was bad, and I knew it was bad, but I still wanted it. And I didn't know why I kept doing it. But then when I looked at God and I realized, why would I do this if I can just use God instead? I was trying to rely on other people, and that doesn't work. You can have hope for other people, but you can't have hope in other people. That doesn't work. And I prayed, and you saw in the video a little bit where we nailed some papers to a cross, and in the morning, they had become flowers. And they had gone away, and they had blossomed into something beautiful. And I nailed that to the cross, and it's gone. And that's because of my hope in God, not because of my hope in other people. My hope in God.
And I want to touch on what you said earlier about how you can have hope in people. You can't have hope in people, but you can have hope for people. And if you don't believe that, look at me. Because you can ask my family. I was a dirtbag. I am. Let me rephrase. I am a dirtbag. I am a dirtbag. But I was not the good kind of dirtbag. Not that there probably is one. I was. I already talked about how I was doing bad stuff. And I talked a little bit about how some bad stuff was happening to me. But I was also being a really bad influence. Because you can't sit here and say, yeah, I'm a Christian, and then do that stuff, you know? Because what's going to happen is, what are you going to do to people who do look at you and say, wow, I want to be like that person? And because, unfortunately, people don't look sometimes when you say that, and they don't think, wow, I want to be like Jesus. They say, wow, look at that person who lives like Jesus. I want to be like them, not like Jesus. And that's why we have to be the example of Jesus, because people don't immediately get it. And so what we do is we mess up. And then those people look at that and they're like, wait, what's going on? And that's a whole nother topic. That's a whole nother subject for another time, which is an amazing thing to teach on. But what I was doing was not what I was preaching. And that's why I say that actions speak louder than words. I have three little brothers. And they are the loves of my life. I love them more than anyone, you know? Except mom. I gotta, shoot. That was a good save. But I mean, they're one of them is literally just like me, which is really scary. But they're all so unique, and I love them so much. And they all look up to me. And the fact that I was over here sneaking out at night, or that I was drinking alcohol all the time because I was depressed. I had depression. It was so hard for me to get out of bed in the morning because I didn't want to go to school. I couldn't look at my mom. Because sometimes you get to that point, and then when people look up to you, and when people are like, maybe this guy that's talking about this Jesus thing, maybe he's got a point. But then they see that you're not living that, they're not going to follow you, and you're going to lead them astray, and that's what I was doing. And so we have to not only have hope in Jesus, but we have to be faithful to what he says for us to do, or else you're going to lead somebody out and you're going to regret it.
I want to touch back a little bit where you were talking about wanting to be other people and not Jesus. I had that for a little bit, and I looked up to somebody that most of this church knows, Isaac Goodner, and I wanted to be him because nobody can be Isaac except Isaac. Because he was so awesome, and he was such a leader, and I wanted to be that. And in that, it blinded me to being what God wanted me to be. I wasn't trying to be myself. I was trying to be other people, and you can't do that. You have to be the best you can be, the you that God wants you to be. You can't hope that you'll become someone else, because you're never going to be somebody else. You can only be you. And without the hope of being the best you, it's hard. It's hard. You end up doing stupid stuff and messing up. You're not the only one that's done that, trust me. And yeah, it sucks. Hard. But you gotta have hope. You have to have faith to God and read his scripture. Psalm 139:14-ish. You are fearfully and wonderfully made. Your works are beautiful, and that my soul knows very well. Roughly. I'm bad at memorizing scripture, sorry. But that scripture helped me to live, literally to live. And you gave that to me, Pete. Without that scripture, I might not be here. Because I didn't have hope in myself. I didn't have hope in myself. I didn't believe in myself at all. And with that scripture, it was, the Bible is the truth. I knew the Bible was the truth. And reading that scripture, it literally said, you are fantastic. Jesus loves you. I was like, I can't dispute that. Dang it.
Yeah. So we want to take a moment to talk about where do we go from here? Maybe you're out there and you're living life and you don't have hope. I mean, maybe you're a teenager, or maybe you're not. Maybe you're someone that's a little bit older than a teenager. If you're living your life and you don't have hope, maybe that's because you're addicted to something, or maybe your relationship isn't working out, or maybe you broke your best friend's heart. We want to take a moment and pray about that. So if you would, with me, would you bow your heads and close your eyes? And if you don't mind following after me. Dear Lord, I'm sorry for what I've done. There's nothing I could do to ever compare to you. I thank you so much for Jesus' sacrifice and the open relationship that I'm able to have with you. I thank you for the hope that you give me and the promise of heaven eternally. God, thank you so much for everything that you've done for me. I love you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Now, we're going to go ahead and bless you guys so you guys can get out of here. Hey, Pastor Steve, we're getting them out of here early. Oof. So, may the Lord bless you and keep you.
And make his face to shine upon you.
May he lift his countenance upon you.
And give you peace.
For you are blessed in the city.
You're blessed in the field.
You are blessed when you come and when you go.
And if the Lord is on your side, who shall you fear?
For who is like the Lord?
Nobody.
Go in peace.